The next item of business is an urgent question, and I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason the Chief Executive of Ferguson Marine had his contract of employment terminated yesterday.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Officer, the termination of the former Chief Executive Officer's contract is a matter for the Board, who are appointed by Ministers to provide strategic direction at Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow. The Chair of Ferguson Marine has stated that this action was necessary to ensure strong leadership amid what a spokesperson for the Board has quoted as calling concerns around performance. My focus and the Scottish Government's focus is, as ever, on the completion of the Glensannex and Hull 802 and to help improve the commercial viability of Ferguson Marine supporting the skilled workforce.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, David Tideman was brutally sacked yesterday. This was the man with the impossible job of turning things around where the previous turnaround director had failed. In fact, to show what he was up against, last October he told the Net Zero Committee that the design of the Glensannex was more complex than a Type 26. Yesterday was disgraceful. David Tideman had only been in post for 2 years. His sacking has sent shockwaves through the yard and the industry. Now, Mary McCallum has said this was a board decision, but Ferguson Marine is owned by the Scottish Government. There's no way this would have happened without her approval. The buck stops with her. Now, I think he was sacked for being too honest about the problems. I think he was sacked for demanding answers from the government about future investment in the yard. But we were told that Mr. Tideman was sacked for performance issues. So what were these performance issues? When did the Cabinet Secretary first become concerned about his performance? Did her predecessor share her concerns? And will David Tideman be getting a payoff, or does he leave with nothing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, David Tideman leaves with the contractual matters which he was due. Graeme Simpson can theorise on this matter as much as he likes, but the facts are that this has been a decision for the Board of Ferguson Marine, who are in place to provide strategic direction and also to hold the executive team to account on performance. Now, the Board are, of course, aware of the importance that I place and the Government places on delivery, on accountability and on the prudent spending of public money. But nonetheless, this is, on its four corners, a decision for the Board. And in respect of Graeme Simpson's characterisation of matters being shockwaves within Ferguson Marine Yard, I would only point to comments from the GMB representative John McMungall on GMS this morning, where he talked of the newly appointed CEO John Pettigrew. He said John's obviously a shipyard man. He served his time in the local shipyard in Greenock before moving. We met with him yesterday. We've had meetings with him over the past 5-6 weeks. We're now going to throw our weight behind John.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, of course the union will work with whoever the boss is. At least they had the guts to turn up on GMS this morning, exactly. Unlike the Cabinet Secretary. Now, the new interim CEO is apparently based in Canada. Canada. I hope he's in British Columbia, where they have an excellent ferry service that we could learn from. How is that arrangement actually going to work? Now, the Cabinet Secretary has said that there will be further delays to the delivery of the Glensannex. So how long will they be? What is the cause of those delays? What is the extra cost? And now that she's wielded the axe, blaming the board, is she personally prepared to commit to a date for the Glensannex and the Glen Rosa to be completed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, just in terms of the incoming CEO, John Pettigrew has 40 years plus experience in shipbuilding. He is a resident of Canada. He will be temporarily relocating to the UK. He knows the business well. He's been a non-executive board member of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow since 2022, and I will certainly take the opportunity to meet with him as soon as I can to make clear Minister's expectations around delivery of the vessels and in respect of support for the workforce going forward. In respect of further delays, I updated Parliament recently in a statement with the delays that were put on the record by the management team. I was made aware on Monday of the board's expectation that there could be further risks. I have no more detail that I'm able to put on the record about that so far, except to say that it's very much my expectation that the newly appointed members will interrogate this and will seek to minimise risk and cost at all opportunities.
Thank you. Before we move on to supplementaries, I will just say there's a very high level of interest in supplementaries, and in order to get through as many as possible and to include as many members as possible, I'll be grateful for concise questions and responses. And I call Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I do want to thank David Tideman for his time at the Yard, but I do also believe it's time for a fresh set of eyes. And so, generally, I'm sorry about some of the rhetoric we've heard from Mr Simpson already this afternoon. It does the Yard no service, or the workforce any service whatsoever. But can the Cabinet Secretary, provide an update with regards to any future work for the Yard, particularly with regards to the Small Vessel Replacement Programme and also the Direct Award? Because certainly the new interim chief executive will require all the assistance he possibly can from the Scottish Government, because he certainly will have that from the shop stewards and the workforce.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I agree with Stuart McMillan's comments around tone and respectful tone, and I don't need to repeat them, but I agree with them. And I want to thank Stuart McMillan for his ongoing support of the Yard. On Small Vessel Replacement Programme, Ministers are considering the outline business case for the programme. This is a very important issue, and an update will be provided once a decision has been taken. However, as I said very recently in the Chamber, direct award of public contracts is only possible in very strictly limited circumstances under public procurement rules. But as I say, Ministers are currently considering future vessel contracts from public agencies, including SVRP.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're rightly critical about this scandal that is costing the taxpayer £400 million. But the people who are paying the biggest price for the latest delay are the islanders, who will endure yet another summer of chaos and disruption. This, alongside ferry breakdowns, is not simply an inconvenience. It'll be the difference between a business surviving or folding, between employers hiring or releasing employees this summer. Therefore, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what support and compensation will the government make available to save businesses and jobs in Scotland's islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I agree with Rhoda Grant, and the islanders are uppermost in my mind, and that's why I've been very clear that delays are entirely unacceptable. And I understand as well the call for support for island communities. I know this is something that, in particular, the Transport Secretary has been involved with. From my perspective, I would point to the relief that was granted in the most recent budget for non-domestic rates relief for island businesses. But in short, I understand entirely the how frustrating the delays are. I will continue to impress upon the board that they are unacceptable, and ministers will continue to consider how we support our island communities short of delivery of the boats.
Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So just to be clear, we're getting a new turnaround chief at the Yard who's replacing the existing turnaround chief who was brought in to turn around the work of the previous turnaround chief, and all at a cost of, I guess, £2-3 million of taxpayers' money. So the real questions, and I haven't heard any answers, is exactly why was Mr Tideman fired? And if he was fired, why is he getting a payoff? How much was he paid off upon his departure? And more importantly, has he signed any non-disclosure agreements?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the decision to terminate the former CEO's contract was a matter for the board, and as I said in my opening response to Graham Simpson, the chair of the board has said that the action was necessary to ensure strong leadership amid what a spokesperson for the board is quoted as calling concerns around performance. And equally, I have already answered the point about payment. Mr Tideman is entitled to contractual payments, which he has or will receive, and nothing more.
Paul O'Kane.
The Cabinet Secretary, in one of her previous responses, chose to selectively quote John McMonagle, the co-convener of the GMB union at the Yard. He also said that David Tideman had inherited an almost impossible job and that arguably out of six or seven CEOs they have had, David has been the best of them. So can the Cabinet Secretary say, when is she going to meet with GMB representatives to hear what they have to say and workers at the Yard who they represent and to listen clearly to their concerns and respond, particularly their ask for direct awards to be made to ensure that we keep this Yard viable and supporting the economy of Inverclyde and Port Glasgow?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very recently met with representatives of the GMB in my office in Parliament, and I will do so soon. I will also very shortly meet with the new CEO and will impress upon him Minister's objectives, namely the completion of the boats, the driving down of costs and the securing of a sustainable future for the Yard.
Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary dares to lecture us about respect, but where's the respect for the taxpayers who've had to bail out this ferry disaster to the tune of hundreds of millions of pounds, or to the islanders who've had to put up with endless delays, or indeed the workers who've been embarrassed by this shocking leadership from this government? Did the Cabinet Secretary know in advance about this sacking? Did she know about the appointment of the successor? Does she know why this had to be done in a hurry, that an interim director had to be appointed? And when will somebody in this government carry the can for this ferry disaster?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, once again, this was a decision for the board and not for ministers. I was made aware on the 28th of February that the board were considering taking action to address performance-related issues in relation to Mr Tideman's tenure, and I was informed on the 18th of March that they intended the contract termination to take place in the week commencing 25th of March.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Tomorrow, I assume, the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee will get an update from the Yard on what's happening. Now, I'm going to ask the Cabinet Secretary in advance of that, what is the actual delay to 801 and what are the actual extra costs? And what are the delays to 802 and the extra costs there? You must know because you said they're unacceptable. Could you tell us?
Cabinet Secretary, with regard to the substantive question.
Yes, absolutely, Presiding Officer, thank you. I gave a statement to Parliament in respect of the most recently formally confirmed costs and expected completion dates. I do not have sufficient information in order to update Parliament with the specificity that I would want to bring to the Chamber. I was formally notified on Monday of potential delays crystallising, but the new executive team and the board will now interrogate those. They will update me and they will update Parliament in the normal way.
Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There should have been a full ministerial statement on this matter. The Scottish Government are ultimately responsible for this fiasco, yet not one of the countless ministers on the ministerial merry-go-round has taken responsibility. The GMB have mentioned so far, and they've been clear, the key change that the Yard needs is investment in facilities and a pipeline of future work. There's cross-party support for that, and it needs to happen now. Does the Minister accept that if the Yard does not get the investment and the small vessel contract it needs, then it is setting up the new management and the new leadership, and crucially, the workforce, to fail?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I have been clear that ministers will leave no stone unturned when it comes to securing a sustainable, successful future for Ferguson Marine. Of course, the best way to secure that future, as I think everybody involved with this knows, is via improved competitiveness. And as I updated Parliament during a statement in recent weeks, we are working with Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow on an updated business case. I am expecting that at the end of this month. I will consider it and I will update Parliament thereafter.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It was asked earlier, but can maybe just ask again, has David Tideman been forced to sign a non-disclosure agreement as part of this payoff from Ferguson Marine, yes or no?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, not as far as I'm aware.
Thank you. Katie Clark.
Mr Tideman was clear that investment was needed for structural changes at the Yard to put it on a firm footing for future orders. He actually said that was required by last Christmas. Is the Cabinet Secretary still considering those representations?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, this question, which Katie Clark is quite right to put, pertains directly to the issue of the business case, which in a previous answer I mentioned we are working with Ferguson Marino on. I'm expecting at the end of the month, and it will be closely considered.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A revised business plan has been prepared, which I believe is to be due to signed off by the Board of FMPG tomorrow. But the fundamental issue remains that the yard needs an order book, which then justifies investment. That fundamental contradiction is not being addressed by the Scottish ministers. So, therefore, the new managing director is doomed to fail unless the government can commit to investment and a forward programme of orders. That is the fundamental problem, and no litany of managing directors is going to solve it. Will the Cabinet Secretary please respond to that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, again, this pertains directly to matters that I've already answered. Ultimately, I think it is worth saying that decisions on what contracts to pursue are ultimately a decision for Ferguson Marine. I've updated members today on the small vessel replacement programme. I do understand the centrality of that in many people's minds to the future of the yard. However, as I've said, it's direct award is only possible in strictly limited circumstances. I've also updated the Chamber in respect of the business case.
Thank you. That concludes the urgent question. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 12669 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. The question is that motion 12669 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 12670 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a Stage 2 timetable. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
I move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. And the question is that motion 12670 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 12671 on committee meeting times. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 12640, in the name of Marie Goujon, on Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 12111 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. We will be moving to a vote, but we'll have a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.